4 years planning for water reuse in northeastern Illinois, and then this parenthetical thing about planning where people think there's an abundant water supply, because we see that as probably one of the biggest barriers that we've run into. When you're sitting next to Lake Michigan with all that fresh water sitting there, people think, why do we have to be more efficient in water use? And I want to acknowledge partners, IIT where I am, your agency, and we partnered with CMAP, Chicago Metropolitan Agency, for planning on this work. This work was sponsored by US EPA Science to Achieve Results program and initially began with funding from Waste Management Research Center. And then I need to acknowledge four students who really have done all the work: Sachin Pradhan, Yiming, Shihu Lo, and Feng Wang. What I'm going to talk about, these are sort of the five major points that I want to get across. One is, and most people here know this, that parts of northeast Illinois are running out of water. We think that water reuse is a part of the solution. There are many things that need to go on, but water reuse should be a big role. I'll mention that industries have hydrologic footprints. We think it's a useful way to assess how efficient industry is using water. And then summarize some issues that affect reuse planning, again, in this part of the country, and talk about planning for an integrated water reuse system. So this figure, these data are some 3 years old, or more than that, I guess, because they came out 3 years ago. But the vertical axis is projected water use or demand, and it's a function of year. And a couple different scenarios here. There's the baseline scenario, which shows these dramatic increases on the pink line on top. On the bottom one is the conservation scenario. If there are some policies that go into place that encourage people to be more efficient in water use. And so that brackets what's going on. And the triangle in there in the middle, the Northeastern Illinois Planning Commission, that's an estimate they came up with for 2020. But the idea is, even under conservation scenario, there's going to be a whole lot more water used in northeastern Illinois. And I think the same authors here came up with a more recent one. Al probably knows how this number has changed since then. I haven't seen it yet. But it looks like we're going to need more water, especially away from the city of Chicago. And the problem, one of the big problems, is we don't use water very efficiently. This is not specific to Illinois or even northeastern Illinois, but across the U.S., according to U.S. EPA estimates, if you look at the amount of water that we use in flushing toilets and outdoor, you've got almost 60% of the water in general, not you people specifically, but in general in your household use, that doesn't have to be the high-quality potable water that comes into your house. It's just kind of a unintended consequence of the way we've designed our water distribution systems, that everybody gets the same high quality water that we really need for kitchen use and for cleaning and shower and bath, but we don't need that same high quality water to flush a toilet or to water a lawn outside. So it's inefficient. In northeast Illinois, and again, this information is a little bit dated because I know there's a lot of people in here that are working to update this information. But almost 90% of the water comes from Lake Michigan. Another roughly 10% comes from aquifers. And about 3% comes from along the Fox River and surface waters. And the problem is that the Lake Michigan withdrawals limited by Supreme Court decree. The aquifers, we know that's a falling water table. We don't have a really good handle yet on how much of a resource is available there. And then for those people that do pull from the Fox River, there's concerns about the minimum flow requirements because of eco-hydrological needs for the river and maintaining wetlands and so on. So, again, this audience, people are pretty familiar with this, but there's a lot of people I've talked to that aren't familiar with. This is the Illinois diversion. So about 54% of the water that we take from Lake Michigan goes through the two water purification plants and out to the users in the city and the surrounding suburbs that get some of the water from Lake Michigan. Ultimately, it goes into the sewer system, to the water treatment plants, into the Chicago Sanitary Ship Canal, the Chicago Waterway System, eventually through Lockport, where a lot of people don't know there's a hydroelectric plant there. So the Water Reclamation District actually generates hydroelectricity and uses that to offset some of their bills. And as you know, it all ends up in the Mississippi River. About a third of the water in the allocation for the Illinois diversion is actually storm water that falls on the Lake Michigan watershed but doesn't make it back into Lake Michigan. And then a small amount is direct diversion, mostly for dilution into the Chicago waterway system. And what we're proposing here is shown by this red line that says, well, if this water's good enough to go downstream for everybody else to use, why don't we take some of it back to the users and encourage them to reuse it locally? In ecosystem study, I guess this would be kind of known as nutrient spiraling. Let's reuse it as many times as we can locally. So we, in the work we're doing, identified these water reuse priorities, and we did them based on what we think the quality should be. And we want to reserve the highest quality water for the potable uses. And we think there are and some opportunities in industry for certain processes and for cooling water. We can use much lower quality water than we're doing now. And so there's a gradient where we, the lowest quality, not, again, not for all industrial uses, because clearly there are some high quality food processing uses and so on where the water quality needs to be potable and higher quality for that matter. But then as we move down here, the quality increases through a number of commercial and domestic uses, and then irrigation, ultimately groundwater recharge, when the intention in some of the far western suburbs might be to replenish groundwater supplies, and then finally potable water. And so those are our priorities. We think for water reuse, the highest priority would be for appropriate industrial processes, and then we move down to the low priority on the end when we think there might be potable water supplies involved. So we started to look and said, if we want to promote industrial reuse, let's look at industries that maybe would benefit. Who would be a good target to look at? So we defined something that I call a hydrologic footprint. And we did this in a really broad industrial ecology sort of sustainable growth way that says the industrial hydrologic footprint will have these five components. One is the obvious one. It's conventional direct water use. That's the pipeline that flows into the industry. And then we said, you know, but they also use electricity, and there's some evaporative water loss with electricity, so let's include that as part of the footprint. And then let's say that there's stormwater runoff. Maybe the industry should be responsible for the physical footprint of their property and the stormwater that falls there, and they should manage that. And then let's even go beyond this to a real industrial ecology sort of broad look, and let's think about the supply chain, because if they're building tables in the industry, well, their supply chain is going to use water in making that table, and so there's some kind of connection involved in that part. And the supply chain uses electricity, and so there's evaporative loss. So we tried to get a handle on all five of these components in hydrologic footprints, and to do this, we wanted to focus on Chicago industry, and we got information on the 50 largest volume water dischargers from the Water Reclamation District. And then we went to EIOLCA.net, and that's put together by some people at Carnegie Mellon. And what they've done is looked at supply chain interactions, and they use it as a life cycle assessment tool. And that was a way that we got into estimating what happens in the supply chain. So you need to keep in mind that the EIO, well, on the top bullet, although we started focusing specifically on Chicago industry, the supply chain, of course, is national and even international, and the information in EIOLCA.net, by the way, that stands for Economic Input Output Life Cycle Assessment. That's what the letters are. And that information is a national average. And so it's not specific to Chicago industry, but it gives us an idea, a way to estimate these kind of fuzzy parts of the footprint. And we normalized all the data to the economic activity of the industry. So it's going to be gallons of water used per dollar of economic activity contributed to the economy. That seemed like a good way to try and talk about the footprints. So here are, here's a summary of information. The vertical axis on the left-hand side is direct electricity use in millions of kilowatt hours. The horizontal axis is direct water use, but that's a log scale, okay? So these are orders of magnitude measured in billions of gallons. And on the vertical axis on the right-hand side, we've converted based on DOE estimates of evaporative water loss, how you go from electricity use to the water associated with it, okay? We started with 50 industries in Chicago, but it turns out with EIOLCANET, you want to focus on industry sectors. And so we found out that we had actually 31 unique sectors to talk about. And we got this unusual distribution here showing electricity and water use as a function of the direct water use. These are two components of the footprint. And what the strange thing I thought is this is a log scale, so we've got four orders of magnitude difference in water use, again, normalized to economic activity. So it's kind of a contribution to the local economy. And up there in the right-hand corner, we have people that use an awful lot, relatively speaking, an awful lot of water and an awful lot of electricity for the same economic contribution. And then a middle group here that, you know, do it more efficiently. And then down in the bottom corner, these are people that maybe if you're into planning economic development locally and you're concerned about water supply, maybe these are the kind of industries you want to promote and encourage to come in to your location, because they give you, again, it's normalized, so they give you the same economic activity, but they do it much more efficiently, lower water use and lower electricity use. Now, this was specific to the individual industry sectors. The next part here is looking at the supply chain. The same type of graph, so the vertical axes represent electricity use. On the left, it's direct electricity. On the right, it's the water equivalent from the evaporative loss. And on the bottom, the horizontal scale, that's direct water use in the supply chain. So again, if we focused on an industry in Chicago making tables, they have a supply chain scattered around that does things ranging from paint for the tables to fabricating the metal to transportation. And that's what we tried to capture here. And curiously, this is kind of a linear scale, relatively speaking. There's one outlier up there on the top, but they're both, there's no log scale here. They're linear, and there's some, I thought, unusual linear relationship in the supply chain that suggests, and I think one of the reasons it happens is because although the supply chain model information, the background information, contains something like almost 500 different industrial sectors, there are only less than 60 unique SIC codes that dominate the supply chain. So it sort of builds on the ecological models that if the industry might be considered as the consumer, the producers that they all draw on are very similar to each other. So different relationships between the industry directly and the supply chain that's working with the industry. And what we find in the supply chain, the dominant ones are blast furnace and steel mills. Everybody's making use of that. Industrial inorganic and organic chemicals, paper and paperboard mills, and you can read the list on the way down to plastic materials and resins. So these roughly 8 members of the supply chain, these were the dominant ones that tended to show up in many of the industries that we looked at. So the information there is, if you're going to work with people in the supply chain to make water use more efficient in industry, there, even though it's a huge supply chain in general, there's a rather select group that would have an effect on everybody else that's connected to them. And here's an example of what the footprints look like. I just picked out 4 of the 31 unique codes, and they're identified by the standard industrial classification code on the left, and in case you don't know what those numbers mean, which I certainly wouldn't have, I've named them specifically here. So on the top, we've got somebody that does chocolate and cocoa products in the city of Chicago. And the color code says for that industry, the supply chain direct water use, this green color, that really dominates their footprint. It makes up maybe 90% of water use, again, normalized to their economic activity. And the other parts for that industry are pretty small. At the other extreme on the bottom, wet corn milling in Chicago, their direct water use is huge. That's maybe almost 80% of their hydrologic footprint. And amongst this sampling, you can see they're scattered back and forth, but pretty much throughout all the 31 sectors we saw, we found that the on-site stormwater, that kind of purple color down here, direct electricity use by the industry, again, that's the evaporative loss associated with the thermoelectric generation, and electricity use in the supply chain, the kind of gray color, those three were always pretty small. Now, I don't know how that works around the rest of the country, but at least for the Chicago industry, if you want to focus on footprints and what makes up a hydrologic footprint for an industry, there are two big pieces. Some industries use a lot directly, and so you could work with that industry to make them more efficient in water use. And some industries, the ones that have the large green part, well, maybe it's better, instead of working with them, maybe get more bang for your buck by working, focusing on the supply chain. So here's a summary of the hydrologic footprint part of the information. We think indirect use, whether it's stormwater or electricity, is a relatively small part of the hydrologic footprint. The direct use, either the specific industry or direct use in that industry's supply chain, that tends to make up most of the footprint for the industries we looked at. The supply chains can be important, and they're dominated by a relatively few different types of industries, so you could focus on those. In the industries in Chicago, about 10% of them had a really unusually big footprint relative to others, so their amount of water per dollar of economic activity makes them a pretty good target to focus on for more efficient water use. Maybe there are people to talk to about wastewater reuse because they use a lot of water. Instead of using high-quality raw water, let's talk to them about reusing wastewater. And so then we went on to this next step to say, what are some of the issues that affect water reuse by these industries? And this is a drawing that captures the biggest issues. We start with our water source, mostly Lake Michigan for where we're looking. We go through the users, we go to wastewater treatment. If we want to bring water back through that dashed line, what controls the flow of reuse water would be mostly these five things: the regulations, the risk, whether it's ecosystem or human health risks, the policy of whoever's implementing policy, this could be the company or the local government agency, economics, that's a huge part of it, and then the technology part of it. So we're going to try and look at each one of those little bubbles in a little more detail now. Water reuse regulations, I thought it was kind of surprising. There are no federal water reuse regulations. The federal government, the EPA, has said, we'll give you some guidelines, and they're actually on their second edition of guidelines for water reuse, but it's up to the individual states to decide, local government to decide what kind of regulations should there be for water reuse. If you've seen the same Associated Press results releases that I've seen in the last 3 days, you might see something on the horizon that thinks maybe they're going to might change some of those regulations, but right now there are no water reuse regulations. Back in 2004, anyway, there were about half the states had regulations specific towards water reuse. 16 states just had guidelines, like the federal government does, suggesting what to do for water reuse. And there were 9 states without any regulations or guidelines addressing water reuse at all. Illinois is one of the 25 that does have regulations, but they're specifically towards land application. The idea is you take treated wastewater from a treatment plant and you use it to irrigate forest land or turf grass, some kind of crop. And that's the extent, I mean, there's some substance to it, but it doesn't talk about any other kind of reuse applications right now. So let's look a little bit at risk, and I put them in two major categories here. One is the ecosystem risk, a wide variety of chemical contaminants of concern, and then I think nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus would be the major ecosystem risk. And then human health risk, well, we're concerned about pathogenic organisms, bacteria, virus, protozoa, and then chemical contaminants of concern, pharmaceuticals, pesticides, herbicides, and then the disinfection byproducts that will show up in treated wastewater. With regard to those risks, the EPA says there have not been any confirmed cases of infectious disease resulting from the use of properly treated reclaimed wastewater in the U.S. These next five bullets were supposed to come up afterwards, so you could read that first and think about it, but I thought it was fair to ask questions like this. Well, are there any unconfirmed cases? What about non-infectious diseases? Should we be concerned about those? How long does it take to see the effects? Well, we haven't seen them yet. Maybe it's a lifetime accumulation problem. What about incidental reuse? There's lots and lots of incidental reuse in the U.S., and the way that is written, it seems like they're only talking about planned reclaimed water reuse. And then what about ecosystem risks? Again, it's the anthropogenic human-centered focus here that we're not concerned about what happens to the rest of the ecosystem. So I think, incidental reuse. This will come up later on. Where I live, along the Fox River. There are two communities there, Elgin and Aurora, that pull water from the Fox River for drinking water. And by the time they get down to Aurora, sometimes about over at least a third of the water there is treated wastewater. So it's recycled, but we're not planning on it. Let's look at one of the other bullets. A really big one is economics, and this is one of the things that really was a push in the project that we're finishing up just now. We wanted to see, could we make wastewater economical? Could we go to an industry and say, we're going to give you a choice. You can open this valve and get municipal water to use, which is what you've been doing for the most part all along, or we're going to give you a choice to open this other valve, and this is going to be treated wastewater, and we wanted to see, would that be an economical, would there be an incentive? Would it be a benefit to open this one? Would they save money? So we looked at an optimization approach that said our objective is to minimize the cost of opening this other valve, and we had these kinds of constraints. We wanted to satisfy the demand of the users. We needed to have a mass balance in the distribution system. We couldn't exceed the capacity between the supply and the demand. We had to satisfy water withdrawal, whether it's groundwater in some places or surface water. Had to make sure we weren't doing that. And then we had to meet the water quality needs. And that last one is really pretty fuzzy. We didn't do a very good job at all of putting this into the model because we don't know how to do that yet, I guess, is the simple way to answer it. So what we found is that in this part of the country, where water reuse is relatively novel, the bulk of the cost is the capital cost in putting in a secondary distribution system. If you're going to do this in Chicago, you have to dig up streets, you have to go down a couple meters and put a pipeline in to distribute water to everybody. And that's expensive. Estimates are that's maybe $200 a foot to put that pipeline in. Smaller costs, the pumping operation and maintenance cost is relatively small. Disinfection, many of you might know that wastewater in the city of Chicago, there's some controversy about how this might change, but a lot of it right now is not disinfected before it's discharged. And it, even in the US EPA guidelines, they say, you know, it should be disinfected before you reuse the water. And to be balanced in our look at cost, we also thought we'd keep track. I mentioned the hydroelectric facility. So if you reuse water, you're decreasing that source of revenue to the water reclamation district because there's less water that goes through that plant. But that's a really relatively small loss, less than 1% of the total cost that we looked at. So we find, and this is not any great inspiration or discovery really, but costs have a spatial relationship. So this red dot in the middle represents a water wastewater treatment facility that is a source of treated wastewater. And the green dots represent potential users. And they're going to be distributed somehow around the potential source here. And the amount they use and the distance they use could vary for different locations. But what we identified are these different, just in the sort of a comic book approach here, this graphic illustration. There's a zone here, zone one. It's only got two users in it, all right? And we have to go out the distance of zone one to get the water to them. If we want to reach more users, we have to go out farther, and that means greater capital costs because the pipeline, this new pipeline, has to reach out a greater distance from the source, and the volume demand then increases with distance. Okay, that makes sense. So what we find is that the cost, the supply costs, depend on the flow that you're providing and the distance it goes. Vertical axis is the supply cost. Think of that as a number like dollars per gallon provided as a function of the volume demand. And if you go out one distance, you'd expect to see this kind of a cost curve. This just shows the economy of scale. If you're only providing a small volume of water out at that distance, well, it's pretty expensive. And as you increase, if there are more and more users out there, you can provide more water. It's not, you know, you don't have to pay so much more to put in a larger diameter pipe. It's just digging the hole and laying the pipe to begin with. So the volume that you provide doesn't have such a big effect on the cost of putting in the distribution system. And so the cost per volume then decreases as you provide more and more people. So this green line represents one zone that you might provide users. And if you can, and in any specific location, there is a fixed number of users out there, then they have a certain demand. And so in this graphic illustration, that triangle on that line represents a hypothetical case. Those would be the exact users at this location that happen to be using that amount of water, and therefore we think it'd be that cost. If we go out further, build a pipeline further out, there's another line that's sort of collinear here that has the same economy of scale idea. More users further out, and this is what their supply cost curve would look like. And at any specific location, again, there's a certain demand at a certain distance. And in this, I'm saying, for example, that triangle represents the demand for this hypothetical case. And we went out three zones, and there's one more user out there. And what we find then, what we expect to see will happen, is, as I pointed out, when you increase the flow, it decreases the supply cost. And when you increase the distance to reach more customers, it increases the cost. So you got this trade-off happening. If you put it together, in general, what we might expect to see is a curve like this. The white dotted line represents what might happen at one specific location. And it says then for that location, there is a minimum cost. And maybe if you want to do this in an efficient way, you find out what distance you go to minimize the supply cost, and then in the planning process, so that when you actually go build the line, don't build one out there to zone two or three, build it to zone one and a half or one and a third, whatever it is, that distance, because that's where you get the most bang for your buck in providing water for reuse. So we wanted to test this idea. And this is a map of City of Chicago. Lake Michigan's out there. The green hexagons are wastewater treatment plants for the Water Reclamation District. And all those little red dots, those are what are known as significant industrial users. I mentioned in the footprint analysis, we picked out the 50 big ones in terms of volume from this scatter plot. And here what we're doing is just looking at where they are. They're not necessarily all big users. They can be on this list because of volume or because of quality issues. Those are the two things the district focuses on. But what we wanted to do here was look at it because we know there's a spatial relationship and say, well, if we wanted to take treated wastewater, what looks like a good place to go from a treatment plant to potential users? And what we see are these clusters, and one that looked really good to us that jumps out is the Kiri plant up there, because there's lots of little red dots pretty close to that one. So we took our case study there and took this approach, and we identified 28 significant industrial users there, 16 metal finishers, 4 electroplaters, and 8 others. Not a big discharge amount of water, a little over 1 million gallons per day. We don't know at this point, if we went to them and said, we want you to use treated wastewater, how much would you use? My sense is that most of them would say none. But I picked the number 50% because it's a good place to start, and because in Taiwan they have a national policy, a plan that by the year 20, 2012, they expect their industries to be using about 50% of their water to be treated wastewater. So that was the reason for picking 50% here. We decided we would provide treated effluent for them in our study 12 months a year, and that means we'd have to add into the cost the fact that we'd have to chlorinate 6 more months a year. Right now, the Kiri plant only has to disinfect during the summer months, not during the winter months. And just some background information on the parameters we use. We assumed an interest rate of 6%. We assumed this distribution system would last 40 years. We amortized the costs over 40 years, and then Yiming wanted this to come out all right, so he picked the bottom number here of $75 per foot for the installation fee. So here's a focus on the cluster of industry near Kiri. The green spot, again, is the plant. Surrounding it are these potential users, and there's the street map. And so here's zone one. We have to go out that far to reach them. There's zone two and zone three. This is just drawn subjectively, but obviously we're just moving further and further away. The idea is we have to put a pipeline from that green circle and get it out to the red spots to use it. And it would probably follow the right-of-way of the streets because that's the way the distribution systems go. So that's the path for zone one. This is a logical path if we extend it out to users in zone two, and that's the one for zone three. Okay, so that's what it looks like from an aerial view. And here's what the cost breakdown looks like. Again, supply costs, and now there are real numbers on here. These are dollars per thousands a gallon. And this is the flow rate. We're going out towards about 500,000 gallons a day. Those three curves, the purple, yellow, and green, represent the three different zones, a little over 5 miles, about 8 miles, and 13 miles. And then the red triangles are the users and the volume that we expect would be used at these different distances. And what we see here is, again, the spatial relationship is going to be different probably every place. Our biggest users here are out far from the plant at the 13-mile distance, so we didn't hit a minimum out there yet. Someplace out there, if we got out to a zone four, we'd expect to hit a minimum and go back up. But what we find is that as far as we've gone, the lowest cost is to go all the way out 13 miles and provide them about 500,000 gallons a day out there. And we project a cost, I don't know, from here it looks like it's a little over $2 per 1,000 gallons. Up above there, that dashed line, these people are in Elk Grove Village, and right now their current water use, their water bill, is a little over $4.30 per 1,000 gallons. So it makes economic sense here. We met what we wanted to do, at least at the $75 a foot level, but we can correct that to test it and see how much room there is to maneuver. But this looks, yes?
Your triangle on the green line covers everybody in the area.
It covers the, what was it, 15 industry users that we thought might be using water. This analysis suggests if we went to them and said, look, you can open this valve for $4.30 per 1,000 gallons or this one for $2 a gallon or per 1,000 gallons, and so there could be some incentive to reuse treated wastewater. What we also found out here, I added this other line, and this is Chicago municipal water costs down here. The city of Chicago prides itself, I think I learned, is that they're the second least expensive municipal water in the nation right now. And so there's very little economic incentive for wastewater reuse within the city of Chicago. The water's just too cheap right now. So it's much better targets moving outside of the city of Chicago. Actually, it's the same water in both places, but there's an add-on cost to get it out to Elk Grove Village, and they can charge more for it out there. All right, so if I summarize from the cost analysis we did for Chicago reuse, the pipeline installation costs dominate, and you know, I guess that's not a surprise. You're going to go in and dig up the streets of a city. It's going to be expensive to do that. We think there's really ways to bring that money down, the cost down. You could talk to people about planning other activities when they're digging up the street to replace the steam line or something, take advantage of that and put in the secondary distribution line at that time. Spatial relationships affect the cost. It depends how big the demand is, who the users are, and where they're located relative to the source. That has a huge role in the cost. We think reuse can be cost effective, not so much in the city of Chicago, but as you get out to the suburbs, there can be an economic incentive to think about looking at reuse. And it's clear that Chicago itself is an unusual case study. Municipal water is very inexpensive. There's also something in the structure of the water reclamation. This is Metropolitan Water Reclamation District of Greater Chicago. I'm not enough of an economist, I guess, to understand how this works, but there's some revenue neutral structure for them. When we started on this project, we thought we could go to them and say, look, you're creating a product here. Wastewater, I think, is the only commodity we spend a lot of money and resources to improve its quality, and then we throw it away. And so we thought we could come back to them and say, why don't you guys recognize more of the value here? You can sell it to some users here. But what we learned is if they sold that water and generated more revenue there, at least the way things are structured now, they'd have to give up some revenue somewhere else because of the way they operate. And finally, the city of Chicago has really done a wonderful job with water conservation in the last 5 or 10 years. So the water shortage in the city is not such a pressing issue. That makes the study in the city of Chicago for reuse, the incentives are fading because of economic reasons and policy and so on. But we think the western suburbs would be a good place to consider reuse. There was a drought a few years ago, so people out there recognized that, gosh, I had to water even odd days, or I couldn't wash my car, or my neighbors are saying they don't like living next to me because my lawn turned brown during that period of time, and they wish that wouldn't happen. The municipal water costs are much higher out there, at least 5 times greater in some cases than they are in the city of Chicago. And we know that the groundwater supplies, I mean, Al and his people are doing a good job of answering that question, but they've been uncertain, and there's going to be some uncertainty even as we go ahead trying to figure out how much groundwater is available. And we also know that right now the surface water is already in some cases up to a third treated effluent. So why don't we look at using treated wastewater in the suburbs? There are some new issues out there. Remember the cluster map, that sort of chickenpox outbreak thing? That doesn't happen so much out in the suburbs. The industrial clusters are kind of limited, at least right now. I think what you could do is plan for something like an eco-industrial park where you encourage industries to locate near a wastewater treatment plant, for example. But right now, that doesn't happen very much. They tend to be 5 miles over here and 10 miles up there and scattered around. So the distribution is going to be over longer distances, so that's going to increase the cost. Because of that, we think maybe it makes some sense, if you remember the priorities I had at the beginning, to move through that list a little bit further and think about what are some non-industrial users. The disadvantage here is that it increases human exposure to treated wastewater, but the economics will get better if we can find more users out there. So there are park districts, there are golf courses, there are forest preserves. They're all over out there. Those could be users. If that happens, we have to recognize that in contrast with industry, these people have limited seasonal demand. That's a summer demand thing. And then, as I mentioned, there's potential increased human exposure if we go out to these other users. I think there's a really good opportunity for integrated water reuse planning out there. And these are sort of the two major questions that it would need to be addressed to do this. One is to inventory the available land, and the things to consider there are how does the land fit, how does it meet with the Illinois EPA regulations that are out there right now? Because those regulations talk about things like buffer zones, how far you are from schools homeowners, what's the distance between the land surface and the groundwater, how far you are from wetlands and other things. So that would be a good way to identify what land is available out there now. While you're doing that, you consider what the distance is from the water reclamation plant. And then, I'm a real believer that if there's a good relationship, it's a potential co-users nearby. So if you find some land that's a a forest preserve property that satisfies all those other needs in terms of the slope and the type of soil and the distance, and it happens to be nearby, or to get the pipeline out there you have to go by some industry, boy, that might make a whole lot of sense then to try and arrange those things together. That's integrated planning. And then the people that I've talked to out there, this was even before the AP stories came out, they're concerned about fate and transport. And they want to know, well, what's the likelihood if we go to irrigation on some of our property, our baseball field, our park district property, what about soil, groundwater, and surface water? Do we have to worry about contamination, accumulation? And then another big question out there is there's some pressure from some people who say maybe a conventional activated sludge wastewater treatment plant is not the best way to go if you're concerned about wastewater reuse. Maybe there are some innovative treatment processes. The one out near us that's getting a lot of press is something locally known as a Schaefer system. It's a kind of a hybrid lagoon system that has both aerobic and anaerobic zones. It's basically an extended aeration plant, which would offer much longer treatment times and opportunity for other properties, processes like photolysis to take place to break down some contaminants before you went to irrigation. Anyway, these are the kinds of questions the people I'm talking to would like to have answers to, and we don't have that information yet. And then finally, we were thinking about what are some other reuse incentives. We know that there's this big cost in the distribution system out there, and most of you probably know, reuse in a place like Arizona or Southern California, that's been done for a long time, but they've got it relatively easy because they can put the infrastructure isn't as old as it is here, and they don't have to worry about a pipeline freezing. They don't have to put it down 2 meters underground to do it. So are there other benefits we could associate? If we're going to put in a secondary distribution system, is there something, some other use, some other value associated with that? And so I'm offering a suggestion, which I think is pretty promising here, and it's to think about geothermal heat pumps. Some years ago, EPA said they recognize a geothermal heat pump as the most energy efficient, environmentally clean, and cost-effective space conditioning system available. And the DOE points out that it's low energy consumption, low operating cost, and reduced carbon emissions relative to conventional space heating, whether it's air conditioning or heating processes. So this diagram shows temperature as a function of month. And in red is the Stickney plant, the world's largest wastewater treatment plant, the temperature of their effluent. And in green, these are average monthly temperatures at O'Hare Field. And so you see over much of the year, the Stickney plant, as you might expect, is warmer than the air temperature. That's waste heat now just flowing down the Chicago River. And even in the peak of the summer, there are some times when the Stickney effluent is cool relative to the air temperature. And maybe we could take advantage of that. The effluent could be treated another value besides just being water. It could be a heat source or a heat sink. And there's growing interest in this part of the country in water source heat pumps. The Illinois Clean Energy Community Foundation has experience with, it's more than 20 now, but they put in a number of geothermal demonstration systems around the state. And they use them both for space conditioning, that's heating and air conditioning both, and hot water supply. And they found a payback of less than 10 years with a geothermal system. Relative to a conventional geothermal system, I think there are benefits of working with effluent. It's got a higher temperature when you want to do the heating process, and that suggests there'd be higher efficiency for the heat pump. And you don't have to install a ground loop because you've got this distribution system in place already. And that could be a big benefit for two reasons. If you're not familiar with a geothermal heat pump, this is a cartoon to show what it looks like for a single dwelling. On the side of the house, or on the side, that little box represents a geothermal heat pump. It's like an air conditioner, which is either going to take, in the summertime, it'll take heat out of the house and transfer it into this the ground loop circulating out there underground. And in the wintertime, it'll pull heat out of the water that's circulating from underground and pump it into the house. Okay, and it turns out that roughly 60% of the initial cost of putting in one of these systems is putting in that ground loop, because you got to dig one up and put it outside your house. I actually, about a year ago, invited somebody. There's not a lot of people that do this, but I invited somebody to come to me and talk to me about putting one in at my house, sinking roughly 100 feet deep ground loop under there. And the conventional system that we were going to put in would be around $10,000 for air conditioning and heating, conventional air conditioning and furnace. And to go with a ground loop system would about double that cost. And I confess I wimped out. I went with the cheap system. I still feel badly about it. So if you went to a dual purpose distribution system, you have now integrated infrastructure. You've got a non-potable water supply out there for flushing toilets and for industrial use and maybe some irrigation. And now you've got a ground loop there for a heat pump system, which offers great advantages. If you do them both at the same time, I think that makes a lot of sense. It raises some new issues and some of the same ones that came up before. The economics of a dual purpose system. What's the trade-off when you have to have some water going for irrigation and some water? Does that decrease what's available for the heat pump system then? I don't know how that works yet. We're looking into that right now. It's a new area for regulations. I don't think there are hurdles here, but it's, again, something that hasn't been tested very much yet. I think there are some interesting technology applications, because in a ground loop heat pump, it's a sealed system and you treat the water, you know what's there. In a water reuse system, the chemistry is different. It's a little more variable, and there's opportunity, for example, for biological growth, biofilm development in the system, maybe enhanced corrosion. There's some things that need to be looked into. The risk here, I think it's pretty much still a contained system, so I'm not so concerned about human health risk or ecosystem risk in the integrated loop. But I think there might be some infrastructure risk, again, for either accelerated corrosion opportunities or fouling or biofilm growth. And then it's a policy issue. Someone has to decide that it makes sense to go ahead and do this. And so it takes creative leadership to do that, I think. Okay, just summary thoughts to wrap up. We think water reuse can help meet the demand. It's not the only issue. There are things about appropriate cost. There are things that need to be done about possibly identifying new sources of water, and certainly we could all be more efficient in how we use water right now, but water reuse could be a big part of it. I think there's this useful concept of a hydrologic footprint. You go out and you look at industries and you understand how efficiently do they use water, and a way to talk about it is the industries there giving economic contribution to the community and your livelihood. And maybe you ought to balance that in terms of how well they use water in the process. In reuse specifically, we see incentives and barriers. They're kind of soft ones. The technology is okay to work with. The technology is there to make it work. The policies can be there to make it work if people want to do it. And the regulations have evolved, and clearly other parts of the country have done it well. The hard parts and the barriers are the public perceptions and the economics. There are some places the economics don't seem to work, at least at the current water costs in the city of Chicago. Outside of the city of Chicago, we think it can be economical, especially if you consider integrated planning for multiple uses, so it's both industrial use and commercial use, as well as perhaps irrigation uses and planning land that's used for parks and recreation and maintaining open spaces. And then the last one, again, if you think about it, it's not just a supply of water that's going through there. It's got some other uses in something like a groundwater geothermal heat pump system. Okay, that's it. Thank you, and happy to have any questions. Yes?
You mentioned the shaper system. I did some work with him quite a while ago when livestock waste was an issue in tourist facilities. The big problem then was the sewer treatment plants and water districts in a lot of the suburban areas, surrounding areas, did not want a shaper system going in because they thought it cut into their business or their potential business. Has that changed any?
No.
It was a very short-sighted view that the municipalities and the districts were taking.
Well, I don't know. I wouldn't criticize them necessarily being short-sighted. It's an important part of the economics of it. It relates to everything here in wastewater reuse. I'll answer your question and then see show it ties into the rest of it. Because when those people built their wastewater treatment plant, they projected out 20, 30, 40 years with the bonds, and they projected for the users. And so they're scaled up for that demand in the future. And if you come in and say, well, you know, those 10,000 users you had planned for, we're not going to put them on your system anymore. We're going to do reuse with them over here. That's a dent in their planning process, which kind of messed things up. We've run into that same issue in reuse, where I thought of wastewater reuse as a new potential market and income stream for the wastewater utility. It turns out that if you have the water supply utility, and these are two different players, the water supply people went through that same process and planned for growth and users 20, 30 years down line. And if you put a dent in their supply, that messes up their planning process too. So economics get really interesting.
Well, 10 years later, the Shaper system still looking like it's viable in terms of, does it meet the expectations for providing water that's clean and is there for a long time?
I, like you, am a big fan of those systems right now. I think they offer promise in nutrient control, which is going to be a big pressure for the treatment people. I think they offer promise in biosolids mineralization. If you can do something to deal with a treatment plant having to manage biosolids afterwards, that's a huge cost. And I think they offer potentially a big help for some of these pharmaceutical and personal care products that are coming out because of their incredibly long exposure time and basically an infinite solids retention time. So a lot of the very hydrophobic compounds that are coming out in a wastewater treatment plant right now, they might just sit there for an indefinite period of time in a Shaefer system. So I think there's real promise for those systems.
I have a rumor to pass on, and then I have a question. The rumor is, I heard yesterday that Chicago is planning over the next 3 years to raise its rates 15% a year. So that might change.
The economics are getting better,
The other question I have is, have you thought about, when you've sized these the distribution systems for cost purposes and looked at the pressures that need to be provided, have you thought about fire protection and whether or not those reuse systems could be usable for fire protection?
Yeah, actually, that's an excellent thought, because that's another place. Conventional design, I'm an engineer, so I can criticize engineering education. Engineers are taught when they design water distribution systems that will take very high-quality water that it has to be sized so you can put out a fire someplace. And if you have a secondary distribution system in place, you could cut down on the size of the high-quality water distribution system, because that, again, is maybe 50% of the water we use needs, the water that we use needs to be that high-quality water. So that could be a very well-designed, very well-maintained, smaller system for high-quality uses. And for things such as fire prevention, many industrial uses, toilet flushing and things, you could have a secondary distribution system, a much larger volume system, but lower quality water. Oh, and related to this, since you mentioned pressure, one of the things I didn't know, but some of the industries we talked to said they would love to have another system. If it's cheaper, that's good, but if it's reliable pressure, that's even better. Because a lot of municipal systems, they can't get the pressure they want.
So, a quick one, direct water use. What are the source of the data on that? Was it the incoming water into the plant or outgoing water?
Yeah, that's a very good question. We started by identifying the significant industrial users based on volume. So that was their discharge to the water reclamation district.
So it does not include incorporation of water into the product,
any drying water? Yeah, evaporative losses or product water are not captured there, so the number could be bigger.
The other comment I had is, seems like you bring up risks, you brought it up a number of times in the presentation.
But it seems like it is more of a perceived additional incremental risk rather than a real risk, because I think you mentioned other communities are already doing this in influences. For example, Florida has a dual distribution system. I know other parts of Southwest have that. So is this really a straw man that you're putting out so that, you know, or is it really there's something to it?
Well, I think it's both. I mean, you're right. There's a history out there of water reuse in arid parts of our country and other parts of the world, and it seems to have worked very well for a long time. So the big public barrier is the perception one that says, wait a minute, I don't want that dirty water coming into my house or being on my yard. But in fairness, even in those other parts of the country, I think there are some risk questions that haven't been addressed yet. So they're both there. Yes?
Could you address what economic data you use to, how do you develop that to normalize the hydrologic footprint? Is it, it seemed like you were talking about specific businesses, but then you have to draw...
Right, yeah, let me so we started by identifying specific businesses, which I identified here in a generic way, but then we wanted to incorporate it with the supply chain and that information. We went with economic activity based on a nationwide model for those industries. So in that sense, we're getting away. We identified the 50 industries in Chicago based on large volume, and then we made a leap from there to this nationwide model, because that's where we could get the data to do this kind of analysis. So that's a really good question, because I don't want to be pointing the fingers at specific Chicago industries, but it's hard to get that information right now.
One comment and two quick questions. First of all, you know, I have at least three friends in Champaign that about 20 years ago they installed heat pumps. The yearly energy cost is about $500. So I really encourage you, if you're trying to stay in your home for under 10 years, to spend the $10,000. Yeah.
Well, you're making me feel worse. I told you I regret it. Now I feel worse.
two quick questions. Number one, you mentioned briefly the Carnegie Mellon program.
Yes.
Did you include the life cycle assessment when you were doing this, your analysis? Look at the environmental impacts rather in addition to the cost.
Yeah, no, you caught me. We've talked about this. We're starting to do some of this right now where we... looking at, for example, CO2 emissions. If you think about an industry, if they keep using raw municipal water all the time, there are all the treatment costs involved in that, and then they discharge and it goes through the wastewater treatment plant, and so there's a lot of carbon emissions related to the energy costs there and so on. But if they take so if instead of taking raw water all the time, if they reuse treated wastewater, you decrease that footprint. So
the other question I have is that, because I think you're really doing wonderful decision-making the board. And even though maybe Chicago is very expensive, do you think there are plans that when the city expands to other subdivisions, new areas, that they can incorporate this type of infrastructure in future developments, so that hopefully in the future there is always this... kind of mentality that we should have this kind of planning to conserve water for industrial or domestic.
Yeah, I don't see all that much opportunity in the city of Chicago itself, because what you're saying, you'd almost have to go back to brand new development. There's not a lot of opportunity for that. So I think the challenge, and I think it's a fascinating challenge, is to train people to think ahead so that when they're doing other preventive maintenance things, to go in and put the system in. But along those lines, the regional water supply planning effort that's going on in Chicago right now, a mayor from one of the far western suburbs, that's where they're doing the new stuff, where they're taking a cornfield and putting in new stuff. He gave me his card and said, contact me. I'd like to talk about putting in the secondary distribution system. So there's hope.
Okay.